to say a couple of things about writing itself, the style of writing through paper. There's been a tendency in modern English to drift into org speak because so much of the conversations that we have are artificial. Thank you for calling Dell. How can I provide you with excellent service today? This is the automatic answering machine of your doctor. Tell me your symptoms and I will run you through the computer, your diagnosis. So what I'm trying to say is that conversation is degenerating and therefore thinking is degenerating and writing is degenerating, and I don't like degeneracy. And even if I had not been a professor of comparative literature, I'm very keen on preserving the flexibility and the expressiveness of language. I know that it's not the same as thinking, but it's keyed to thinking. When people can't express themselves articulately, they usually can't think very articulately, and then if you tell them, you know, vote for the Republicans or Al-Qaeda will get you, they jump for it. So this is all very real to me, that we should be able to think and write well. So I think some of the things to avoid so that this modern speak doesn't get to us is watch out for the passive voice. After you've written your paper, look over the whole thing, and wherever you say, this was decided upon, go back and change it to the participants decided. And just try to use the active rather than the passive voice. You can see the connection between that and responsibility, actually. Watch out for false subjects like the movement decided it would be a good idea. Movements are abstract entities. They can't decide anything. Only people can decide. So go back and write, the participants in the movement on the whole decided so-and-so. Other than that, I think general ideas about writing simply and clearly, wherever you can pick them up from any writer's guide. Generally speaking, like I have macros in my computer that knock out 3 words, 5 words, 6 words, and this is basically what editing is about, is taking out words that don't need to be there. I think it's about all that I can say. We've tried making a few other comments on your paragraphs, the selected paragraphs when you gave them to us. You did. Okay. Eli?
Were you going to say something about
yes. That was going to be my next thing. For paper topics, most of the topics that we looked at were very good. We're really looking forward to seeing them. A type of topic that may not get anywhere but is very tempting to try to do is a compare and contrast thing, period, end of quote, where you say, I'm going to compare Gandhi's movement with King's movement. They have these similarities and those differences. Goodbye. That doesn't really get us anywhere. You want to have something that you're exploring. Why were those differences there? Were they differences because of a different culture? Were the differences because King saw things differently? Were the differences because he didn't understand something? So set out with a thesis that you're going to use that set of comparisons and contrasts for, or otherwise we have found in the past that these papers don't tell us much. Okay? So to remind you, the papers are due on the last class meeting, which is Thursday, December 7th. And remember, I have nominated that we reinterpret, reapply December 7th and celebrate the passing of the great law. And December 7th, was that 1789 or something like that, when the territory of Pennsylvania adopted the great law under William Penn. That's what December 7th means to me. So what we're going to do now is I wanted to talk about three episodes or facts about the civil rights movement and King very quickly, and then look at this sort of overview diagram that you have in your reader on page 287, and we'll put up here in a slide when the time comes. The three things I wanted to quickly touch on, I realize that we're falling behind, but that's the sign of a good course, right? Or one of them. First of all, there's a really big issue that differentiates these two as people and possibly as leaders. And you pick this up right away in the last section of Frady's biography of Martin Luther King. And that is, for Gandhi, Brahmacharya was very important. It was essential. And you remember my little observation that he takes the final vow in July of 1906, and just 3 months later he's presented with this terrific challenge, to which he rises on September 11th to launch Satyagraha at a very, very powerful and very deep level. And he had various theoretical explanations of why control of the sexual faculty was important, and it goes very, very deep into his spiritual background in India. It was very important for him. You could say it was like central to his effectiveness as a leader. This is definitely not the case for Martin Luther King. Period, end of quote. I'm not going to say anything more about it. I just leave it for you to ponder and to reflect over. But this, on the personal level, this was a significant difference between the two people. The next two things that I have to say are much less controversial, and they deal with two of the movements and things that happened there. We didn't talk much about Albany in 1961-62. It was in many ways the low point of the entire civil rights movement. King was not involved in the planning. He was dragged into it unwillingly. He points out that one of the big mistakes they made was that they wanted desegregation. That's way too general. As opposed, they wanted everything and got nothing. Now, he will be very clear that even though the Albany episode was a failure in terms of what we call work, quote unquote, or success, there were still very significant gains that happened there. And if nothing, even if nothing had happened in terms of having an impact on the white citizens and on the rest of the country, the participants learned a great deal, and citizens of Albany, Georgia, which was a very, very segregated area, were able to get up off their feet, off their back, I mean stand up on their own 2 feet, for the first time. So it's a very good laboratory to look at work versus work. But also, there's a very interesting feature of the Albany campaign, and that's why Laurie Pritchett's name occurs here, the police chief, on your little list, because he basically outfoxed the movement. They had developed a strategy of provoking harsh response, which was not very difficult in the South. You know, all you had to do is, like, look at Emmett Till. I mean, all you had to do was whistle at a white woman and you could provoke a lynching. So it wasn't hard to prod those people into a harsh response. In fact, I've made the case that if you look at the present administration, that's a weakness that they have also, which we have not yet exploited. But there's a little episode in Jackson, Oregon, where protesters, what they were doing was holding up signs saying that they were not for Bush, and he ordered his squad out of these vans to beat these people and drive them back off the sidewalk. It's easy to provoke a paradox of repression in certain people if you play your cards right. However, Laurie Pritchett had read the papers and he knew what happened in Birmingham and Montgomery, and he instructed his police to be very, very polite to the protesters, which is what happens if you protest in Washington, D.C. They're very nice to you. Kindly come this way for some pepper spray if you don't mind, as opposed to just, you know, beating you over the head. So because the movement had really relied on this rhythm, on this scenario, they said, we're going to do something that'll provoke a response, they will overreact and the press will cover it, the nation will see what happened, and we'll have an advance. It worked very well. They're kind of relying on this as a formula. In Albany, it didn't work, because Pritchett was just a little bit smarter than they had calculated. So I think what we learn from this is not to rely on any one set of tactics, because your adversary is not always totally predictable, as on the strategic level. On the theoretical level, King said this is an example of using nonviolent tactics for what he called an immoral cause. And he said this is not right. You shouldn't do it. You cannot use immoral means for a moral end, and you cannot use moral means for an immoral end. Well, I'm more interested in the dynamic of it, whether it works or not. In fact, what Lori Pritchett did, as far as he was concerned, quote, work, unquote, success in the short term, it did work for him. And pragmatically, that does show you that you have to have different, you have to be flexible as far as tactics is concerned. If you want to be absolutely inflexible on principles, there are some things for which you may be willing to lay down your life. Absolutely unacceptable and non-negotiable. But those have got to be very deep nonviolent principles, and they'll usually be very few in number. Everything else is negotiable. And the most negotiable stuff is the particular tactic that you're going to use in a particular situation. What was the other thing? Yes, the other thing was the following set of events. King had gotten pretty close to Johnson, LBJ, and went to him at one point and said, we need a Voters' Rights Act. Johnson said, we're nowhere near ready to do that. Can't give you that, I'll lose the South. If I lose the South, the Democratic Party falls apart. In fact, this is in the long run what happened. This is one of the reasons we have, I mean, there's several reasons we have a Republican administration now. We don't need to go into all of them, but one of them certainly is, one factor is that you had this weird structure in the U.S. where Dixiecrats, as they were called, Southern Democrats, were upholding segregation, but they were voting with the Democratic Party. I don't myself even know how that ever came about. They were Democrats. And of course, they left the party when the federal government weighed in against segregation. Anyway, King goes to Johnson and says, we need the next step. We need a Voters' Rights Act. Johnson says, I'm sorry, we can't give you that. King says, okay, I know what to do. And he goes back out to the streets, and you have six more months of protest. And then he goes back in to visit Johnson again. And Johnson not only signs the Voters' Rights Act, not only gives him the pen, which is what they do in these occasions, but he sings, We Shall Overcome. And people who were in the Oval Office at that time said that that was the only time they saw Martin Luther King Jr. crying in the entire 10 years of the Civil Rights Movement. So it's important for us to realize the complementarity of those two kinds of action. You make your pitch for the legislative, for you put in your petition. If people say no, then you go back out and change the situation on the ground and bring them around to the point where they have to say yes. I think we're very much in that situation now. Okay, anything else then about the Civil Rights Movement? We had several unanswered questions, but we just may have to learn to live with them. Yes, John? Yeah, it would be, well, the first step is definitely persuasion. You lay down your petition. Now, whether the, in this particular case, I think we can assume that Johnson pretty much wanted a Voters' Rights Act, but he was not in a position to do it. They put him in that position. Yeah, I think you could call that persuasion. But it becomes a personal matter, you know, whether it's persuasion or coercion. But it's definitely the case that you have to know the different phases and do them in sequence. You know, you don't do protesting and then come in and submit a petition, because that what you're saying in that case is that your opponent will only listen to pressure. You give them the opportunity to be reasonable. Once they've demonstrated that they will not be, then you have to go to Satyagraha. Incidentally, I heard a talk by Dan Ellsberg on Saturday. He was just great, And one of the things that he reported is that President Bush said to the nation, you know, God told me to hit Osama, and I did. You know, God told me to hit Saddam, and I did. And Ellsberg said, if God tells you to hit Iran, will you please get a second opinion? I'm not sure that's relevant, but I thought it would be at least funny. It wasn't even that, okay. So anything else about the civil rights movement? There's so much that we didn't get to talk about that we could learn from it, but we have to start moving on. I have something I want to – did you have something, Sid? Or
No, I'll talk about it.
I was just wondering, because it seemed like what Gandhi did was very much in the setting of India, and like this was a tradition that people understood and could accept.
Yeah.
It seems like for Martin Luther King, doing that would like almost alienate him from people because they wouldn't understand like exactly like where.
Okay, Sid's point is that we may have a cultural Swadeshi issue here, that, you know, Gandhi goes before the public and says, I'm a brahmachari, I am an urdhvaretu, all of these ancient terms would be very powerful and very meaningful for them. Whereas in the black Baptist community at that time, it would be the opposite of meaningful. They would think it's at very least weird and probably sick. However, hang on a second, Joy. However, this brahmacharya or control of the sexual faculty is a much deeper issue than a cultural issue. It's a deeply personal and spiritual issue. And even if nobody ever found out about Gandhi's brahmacharya, it would still have its main effect, which is to rechannel a very powerful form of energy into the direction that he wanted it to go for the welfare of humanity. Now, on that level, if we decide this thing works or would we decide it doesn't work, it's going to be a universal. Right? Because here we're talking about psychic energy within the human being. I may even have a slide that may be of some use here. Let's see, where we go. If I don't have this particular slide, it's not a disaster. But if I do, it'll be neat. What it's going to be talking about, if it, oh, here we go. Okay, yeah, it's this one. You can think of, wait. Just watch this, guys. Ready? Pretty cool, huh? Okay. If we think about political decisions, like this is what Johnson has to make up here, and then social pressures come to him from down here, those are deeply embedded in cultural values and attitudes, and that's what you were talking about, Sid, that brahmacharya, like many other things, would have one meaning in one cultural context, another in another. But there's a still deeper level where which I'm calling the spiritual, which deals with our vision of who we are, our sense of identity, our purpose, and even things which are not cognitive, but just, I guess the only term I can come up with is a prana or life energy. This is part of our psychobiological inheritance. So at that level, it would have to be universal. And we can't say that at that deep level that this would work for Gandhi, but it would not work for King. Yes?
Did Martin Luther King give up other things that Gandhi
did? Well, if you ask, did Martin Luther King give up other things, he gave up his life. That's a pretty big one. He knew perfectly well. You read any of those speeches toward the end of his career, he knew that he was living on borrowed time. So I think that's, once you give up that, I think. No, I know what you mean. He did not give up liquor. you know, I have no idea whether he was a vegetarian or not, any of these things. He was not, Gerlina's telling me. So that means that Hitler and Gandhi were the only two really prominent vegetarians of the 20th century. Go figure. But I think, you know, his renunciation of his family in the sense that he saw Coretta and the children, there were times there where he saw them maybe once or twice a month. That's a very, very heavy renunciation. So I don't think he can be faulted in general. But okay, here's where we get over toward the segue that I wanted to make towards the economy part. He knew very well that there was buying power among the African Americans, that they should use that in the form of a boycott, though he didn't want to call it a boycott. He wanted to call it non-cooperation with evil. He also knew that they had to improve their own economic circumstances. But as I've mentioned before, he didn't actually go in and physically set up those programs where people would be spinning, making cotton, buying and selling it, setting up networks, the whole incredible network of activities that Khadi led to, basically reorganizing the whole country from the village on up. He didn't actually get involved in doing that. Again, he had 10 years, not 50, and he sort of knew that. So he knew perfectly well that, you know, people would say, oh, if I sit next to a black person on the bus, something terrible will happen to me. I'll get sickle cell anemia, or my ideology will be corrupted or something. But that this is up sort of in this level here. And in reality, when it comes right down to it, people will be much more driven by what affects them economically. And in event after event, when he was able to exert economic pressure, they forgot about all of these ideologies. There is one other point I did want to make, actually. Joy, did you have something to add, or?
Okay. How you view sex. Like,
yeah.
I don't think people's, you know, idea of sex is one static thing. Like some might think it's a really sacred, uplifting, energy producing experience. Some might think it's, you know, like indulging senses.
So okay, Joy's question is a very good one. I had no intention of getting into this area, but here we are. It does, and all I can tell you is my opinion. My opinion is, since you asked me, it does make a difference how you think about it. If you're just indulging in it, you know, as we all know very well, sex can be the most violent force available to human beings. Rape in war is like, it's like just an extension of the most violent thing you can do. On the other hand, it can be the most loving and can be the most creative. I have a very dear friend who is 6 months pregnant, and up in Canada, everybody goes in for ultrasound at, I guess, week 17 or something. So she's sitting there with her husband and the radiologist and herself and the unborn, the not yet born, and, you know, they turn on the machine and the screen is dark and then it starts to take shape and they see this little baby lying on its face, and then it turned. It turned to the camera and opened its eyes and looked as mother and father, and they said, oh, it's you, and went back down. You know. So what am I saying, aside from sharing stories with you? The fact that sexual release can be either the most violent or the most nonviolent thing in human experience just goes to show you how much power it has. So what I want to say in response to your question, Joy, is it does make a difference what your attitude is and how you're thinking about it, but there's a level at which no matter how you think about it, it is a tremendous expenditure of energy. And I remember when I was an undergraduate, so, you know, this is a while ago, but who's counting? There was a psychological experiment where they were measuring the amount of energy that was expended in sex. So I thought, oh, this is going to be interesting. So what they were looking at was like, how much energy does it take to unbutton your shirt, to lie down? It's so stupid, like that isn't a thousandth of the amount of energy that's going to be expended in that experience. But so that was the point at which I decided I was not going to be a psychology major, by the way. I also didn't major in economics for obvious reasons. We'll get to those in a second. But what you want to do with that energy at some point is even deeper, I believe, than your attitude. Yeah. So there are universals there. More than this, I don't know what to say. It's just an extremely interesting observation, something that was, and by the way, Gandhi did not go around saying, I am a brahmachari. You know, as you saw from the Attenborough movie, the only way you knew was asking his wife. Do you remember that comment that he made, that she makes, Kasturba? Oh, this taking vows of celibacy is easy. He did it 5 times. So that also is an indication of how much power is involved. Okay. Anything else about the CRM or MLK? We move on. All right. May we have the house lights dimmed, please. What I'd like to do now is show you a picture of the diagram that you have. But just a little bit prettier. I'm sorry we can't pull this shade because the budget doesn't allow for that. Jerlina, could you get the backlights too? Let's see. So here's my little diagram of the proposition that what Gandhi developed was applicable not only to conflict but to basically every problem that we're facing in the modern world. Again, a version of this is on page 287 of your reader. So what this means is I put satya in here, the word for truth, in Sanskrit, in Devanagari, and quite apart from just showing off, my reason for doing that is I wanted to show that, you know, this in a way is a very, very deep, eternal principle. Satya means truth, but you have to remember for Gandhi, it means truth as opposed to falsehood. It means real as opposed to unreal. And it means good as opposed to not good. Good as opposed to evil. All three of those things are in this very powerful concept that he puts at the center of his life. And you remember he said that truth and nonviolence are two sides of the same coin. But really, truth is the head, and nonviolence is the tail. Nonviolence for him, as important as it was instrumental and not primary. Everything was rooted in his search for truth. And in the course of developing this, here's the arrows going out into the world, you come up with some basic principles, and here's one of them that we've talked about already, Svadeshi, which means start within your own circle. And that is interpreted economically in terms of, for example, not buying British cloth, using homespun cotton instead. So you have this contrast between Svadeshi, what comes from your own country, and Videshi, what comes from somebody else's country. And although he applied it as a means of breaking the economic stranglehold that the Raj had on India, it's a key principle that we can apply today to the empire squared, or the meta-empire, which is globalization. At the time when I did that chart, I just used the word globalization, but today we would call it globalization from above. In other words, the organization of the world as basically a network of corporations and as David Corton has pointed out recently, when we measure the success of an economy today, we measure economic growth. What we're measuring is the transferring of resources from the earth into garbage and the transferring of wealth from the poor to the wealthy. Though if you look at the economic indicators, an economy will have high marks that when it does those two things. And the opposite of globalization, which is centralize everything, you know, get network of trade regulations so that corporations have absolute control. The opposite of that is Swadeshi, where you build up control from the most local level to the most global. And you do go up to the global level. You don't stop with your own circle, but you have to start with your own circle. So when you think that it takes 265 calories to ship a strawberry from San Francisco to New York, and when you eat that strawberry, you get 5 calories out of it, you'll realize that globalization is not sustainable. We're going to have to rediscover local Swadeshi on the economic level. Swadeshi on the political level meant that instead of creating a body called, let's say, the United Nations and give it an army and absolute power over the whole world, like a super nation state, you organize the world so that, and this is a direct quote from Gandhi, the individual serves the family serves the village serves the district serves the state serves the nation serves the world. So you operate. Two things are hugely different between present attempts to organize the world and Gandhi's alternative model. One is that you're starting from the individual, not from a map of the world with little triangles and force parameters and stuff. You're starting from the bottom, if you will, not from the top. And secondly, that the mode of relationship from one unit to the next is service, not extraction of service, not exploitation. So let me just quickly go around the other problems and the concepts that could be applied directly to those problems, say a little bit about each one, and then for now, pull out the economic ones, and maybe after Thanksgiving, which I wish you a happy one of, by the way, look at the conflict ones and some of the others. So going around here to 2 o'clock, we have a humongous problem which was not nearly as big in India as it is here today. We have, in the United States, we have 2 million people who are in the criminal justice system. There's about slightly under a million of them actually incarcerated and others various kinds of difficulties. Now, there were several different things that Gandhi said about crime in different contexts, but the one that I pull out as the principle within constructive program that would fix the criminal justice problem is the one that he called Nai Talim, which means new education. Gandhian education scheme is actually something that's still very much being practiced in many, many little rural schools all over India. I have met people who are who were raised in Gandhian schools. Joy? Okay, here's how Nai Talim worked. Here's how the educational system worked. First of all, whatever you learned, you had to learn from hands-on practical experience. That is, you're going to learn math. Okay, a teacher is not going to come in and write algebraic equations on the board and say, memorize these. This is math. Instead, you're going to go out and, let's say, harvest the rice that you grow. You have an edible schoolyard like they have in Oakland. You harvest the rice, you bring it in, you weigh it. That gives you numbers. You work with those numbers. From those numbers, you work up to a knowledge of mathematics. It is spiritual in the sense that you start it every day with prayer meetings. It's spiritual in the sense that you are learning to develop your capacity to serve. And yeah, Amy?
Elon,
I'm sorry. Gandhi didn't spend a whole lot of energy on that. He probably would have felt that literary experience can be a mere indulgence, or it can have some use. If it's a mere indulgence, you become what they call in German ein Schöngeist. You're just, you know, looking for aesthetic pleasure. I don't think he had much interest in it. But if you're going to help interpret the Bhagavad Gita, the Mahabharata, or use it in prayer meetings or things like that, he was very interested in it. So Naitalim, I guess, Ilana, your question really is, was Naitalim designed for higher education? He hadn't really thought that far. It really was a way to raise school kids. Joy? Yeah, you have to remember that in the traditional Indian image of the human being, intellect does not have the highest place. When Swami Vivekananda came to this country 106 years ago, and he spent some time exploring the U.S., he made a few statements about where we were at from his perspective. He could shed some light coming from a different culture. And one of the things he said was, the besetting evil of you people here in the West is that you educate for the head only and not for the heart. And he said, that will only make you 10 times greedier than you already are. And he said, that will be the ruin of you. And frankly, because you haven't asked my opinion, I will nonetheless tell you that I think he was absolutely right. And for me, the classic example of misusing the intellect is the nuclear weapons labs being run by the University of California. I can't imagine anything that would pervert education more deeply than that. And please don't get me started, because I worked on this issue, and I'll be crying here, and it will be very embarrassing. But for another example, the Californian magazine, our alumni magazine cover professor this quarter was from the law school, is Professor John Yu. He's the person who has given the president the legal language which enables him to practice torture and override habeas corpus, which takes us back to the 12th century in terms of human rights. We were now earlier than the Magna Carta in this country. And the subhead for the article was, John Yu says we have to practice torture and all this stuff. Does he have a point? Now, the question is not, does he have a point? Of course you have a point. You can always make a point. That's what that's what studying the law is for. The question is not, does he have a point? It's, does he have a heart? Does he realize what he's empowering an extremely short-sighted person to do to human beings? And once you ask the question, does he have a point, nobody's going to come up and nobody except us is going to come up and say, wait a minute, that's not the issue. So actually, I think this is actually get around to your question, Ilana. I think Gandhi was not terribly interested in developing the intellect for the intellect's sake. That he felt that if you gave people an orientation and a purpose in life, if they had a good intellect, they would use it. If they didn't have a purpose in life, their intellect would use them. And they would be like, what is it that Gandhi says about, Dante says about people in the lowest circle of hell. He meets people down there, qui hanno perduti il ben dell'intelletto. They've lost the good of their intellect. Is it going to be like what we were saying about sex in a funny way? The intellect has a lot of neutral power that you could use for very good or very bad purposes. Okay, but let's move on. If you can read it, this problem down here is poverty. And in fact, I wanted to show you something about the distribution of wealth in the United States. If you haven't seen this chart, This chart was actually drawn up by an astronomer who did it because he had a hard time getting his students to kind of sense what a billion meant. You know, if you're an astronomer, you have to talk billions, trillions, and it's all just a few letters. So he's trying to give them a sense of what a billion is. And he said the best way to do that was to make this chart of the economic distribution of the United States. So the poorest people are here, you know, we're right here, and the richest people are here. And what you're measuring is what is the height of your income in $100 bills? Because your students are off here in the end zone, right? You're just negative income at this point. But professors about here at the 2-yard line. So he thought what he would get was a curve where you had, you know, poor people and then not so poor people and rich people and then Bill Gates. But in fact, there is a small number of people who have so much wealth that they're literally off the chart and everybody else doesn't even make a blip. We're not a pixel on a computer. And then you ask yourself, well, how far off the chart do these people go? That's how far. This is Mount Everest down here. And here's, you know, this is like a handful of people, less than a half pixel wide of people on the football field. So this incredible maldistribution is also the same picture. It can be duplicated worldwide. In other words, you know, there's 200 people that have more wealth than the bottom 400 million people, or something like that. So poverty and maldistribution of wealth is a humongous problem, and the issue, the principle that solves it, which I pulled out that can solve it, you could do this other ways as well, is something called trusteeship. And let's get back to that very soon and talk about what trusteeship means and how it fits in to Gandhian economics as a whole. Now, about racism, I don't know if you can read that, but that's my bottom problem here. The principle that fixes it is heart unity. Anybody want to paraphrase just quickly what heart unity is, what it means? You are going to be very sad if you can't do this on December 10th or 14th. Amy?
Just the idea that we are all interconnected. We all have something in common and we're dependent on each other, so we're all equal.
Okay, that's part of it. That's definitely the basis of it, Philip. Hang on, let me repeat that for you. That we are all interconnected and there is some unity among all of us is the basis of it, no question. Philip? That is really how heart unity works. That you want the other person to succeed, whoever that other person is. You want them to be fulfilled. And remember that one of the definitions of violence by Johann Galtung, in fact, was any avoidable compromise or inhibition of a person's fulfillment is violence. If somebody is not being fulfilled in a way that I could have done something about, I am in a way involved, at least in structural or indirect violence against that person. So the reason that this is called heart unity, that it's to differentiate it from social unity, financial unity, skin color unity, DNA unity, any of those things. All of those things are on the surface, and you do not have to have unity in regard to any of them. In fact, you basically don't want to. But if you have nothing but these surface differences to think about, as we've seen over and over again, it's going to precipitate horrendous conflicts. So this is a unity and diversity model, and the key to it is that you have to hold unity at the heart level and diversity at the surface. You don't want to mix them. You don't want to have diversity at the heart level because then that becomes disunity. And you certainly don't want to have uniformity at the surface level. Because I'm going to be saying, I only like people who have the same characteristic as that I do. So yeah, John?
Did Philip by all means mean
You don't have to excuse me. I am getting carried away with this talk. You don't have to limit heart unity to humans. I'm going to come back to this. I'll just put it on the board now, and we'll come back to it later. But I see the problems of the world right now as three intersecting ones. And it's the environmental one. Don't worry that you can't quite see it yet. And the question of violence and the question of poverty as sort of the three big intersecting areas. And the reason I mention it here is, in a way, the Earth, you can either think of the Earth as a living system. This is the Gaia hypothesis. If you don't do that, you have to recognize it as a life support system. If you damage the Earth's ability to support life, like remember that ozone layer that we saw on the last slide, you're violating the Earth. And well, I guess we backed into this through the question of heart unity, and I think I went a little bit too far with talking about the Earth as a creature. But yes, you can have heart unity with creatures. I mean, I live in this place out in the country, and we have a whole bunch of creatures living with us, major creatures, I mean, as opposed to mosquitoes and daddy long legs and things like that. But we have foxes, deer, rabbits, and quail, occasional bobcat. Once we saw a mountain lion, but we don't consider them part of our community, and turkeys. And the fact is, we have a hard time extending heart unity to the turkeys. After they visited our garden and made off with two-thirds of our chard, so they've got a lot of problems for us. They're ugly. They make stupid noises. They're aggressive. They leave material that we can't use all over our paths and stuff like that. But the fact is that from the nonviolence point of view, they're just creatures trying to make a living, just trying to pick up some seeds and reproduce. That's what turkeys do. Unfortunately, they do it very successfully. And heart unity would say, okay, even though we don't like the way you look, you have this incredibly stupid thing hanging down under your neck, okay, but for you, you're a perfect turkey. No, I'm sorry, that sounded weird. but you know what I'm getting at, that we should want them to thrive. We do want them to thrive, but just not on our property, okay? So that would be a place where we have to kind of push it to develop our unity. But we should recognize that, you know, those creatures play a role in the scheme of things, and they have every right to live. And you know what? There were turkeys here on Turtle Island before there were pale faces. So, okay. All right, well, let's move on so I'll have enough time to get back to the economics part. A little problem called war. Now, I choose war. There's other problems of violence, of course. There's smaller problems with armed conflict. There's violence in 100 different ways. But I chose war because that's the biggest one in terms of scale, and it's always used as an excuse for why we can't have nonviolence. So if nonviolence does not come up with a response to the war system, it basically won't get very far. It will not be able to establish itself as a principle in human nature, which we can use. Now, Gandhi had an invention. It was not just a concept. He actually put it into practice, called the Shanti Sena, which stands for the Peace Army. And out of that institution, since he passed on, we have developed two responses to the war system, which are based on nonviolence. And we'll talk about them after the holiday, but I'll just mention them now. One is called civilian-based defense, and the other is called third-party nonviolent intervention. Civilian-based defense, or CBD, is something that you basically do yourself, your own society. Third-party nonviolent intervention is where you go and intervene in a conflict that's taking place somewhere else in the world. And if you think about the Shanti Senas that Gandhi set up in India, and you think about the story of Abdul Ghaffar Khan, we'll have a good background for going into both of those things. And what I'll do is talk about the general principle here, and then next semester we'll talk about what's actually going on in both of these areas. TPNI is much more dynamic than CBD right now, just as a trailer for PACS 164B. Now, the last one is the general question of alienation. I was thinking about this morning. I almost never see films, commercial films, that is. I see documentaries 5 times a week, but I never see commercial films, unless I have a special reason to. And I used to see these billboards for a movie. It was called Mr. and Mrs. Smith. He's this very ordinary, handsome couple, except they're carrying weapons. I had no idea what actually went on in the film. Then I went to Houston, I think, to give a talk, and they were showing Mr. and Mrs. Smith. And so it's not like I actually put my earphones on and listened to it, but I could see what was the plot of this movie. And what the plot is, these people are professional assassins who fall in somewhere in Central America. They fall in with one another. They're both physically attractive. They don't believe in brahmacharya. So the next thing, this is Hollywood. So the next thing you know is the next thing you know. But in this case, they also actually get married. And the marriage lasts about 3 weeks. It's not based on surface. It's based on self-gratification. And they get bored with one another. And the next thing you know, there's a hit on one of them, and it's farmed out to the other one. So I think it's Mrs. Smith who gets the contract to kill Mr. Smith, and the last part of the movie is how they try to kill each other. So, you know, my spiritual teacher, Eknath Ishwaran, used to say modern literature is a literature of alienation. This, like, proves that to the nth degree. I cannot imagine anything more alienating than this movie. And now, why did they call it Mr. and Mrs. Smith? What is the point here? They are trying to normalize alienation. They're just bringing it into the Smith is like the quintessential Anglo name, right? This is the most common Anglo name. It stands for, you know, it's like Giuseppe in Italian or Schmidt in German, for that matter. So what they're trying to do is take this extreme alienation. It could not be more extreme, where one person is literally trying to kill the other person, and embed that as the absolute norm of bourgeois American existence. So, why am I saying all of this? Because I obviously had a horrible time on that airplane, and I want to vent and make myself feel a little better. I'm also because I'm trying to say that alienation is a huge problem in our culture. And just 1 second, Joy. And I think that if you wanted to pull out one gun, you could do it with heart unity, you know, you could do it with others. But one that's left over that we haven't touched on yet and which will also be part of the economic set is service. And once you have people feel that their purpose in life is to be of service to others, then they will overcome their alienation. I teach a little sophomore seminar called, you know, Why Are We Here? Great writers on the purpose of life. And the purpose that comes up most often anywhere is we are here to help others. In fact, there's sort of a joke that somebody came up with that we start off the course with where somebody says, we're here to help others, that is for sure. What others are here for, I haven't the faintest idea. Okay, Joy? If there's any reason to think that a relationship had any basis, alienation will betray that relationship. But yeah, alienation is radical separateness, where it's the belief in win-lose structures of relationships such that in order for me to be happy, you may have to be unhappy. In fact, in the extreme form, It's through your unhappiness that I get happy. That's where you have gladiators. John?
The prevailing paradigm, because it is based on materialism, inevitably brings up a separate model of, says that all creatures are separate because they're bodies and just look at them. And then that means that alienation is inevitable, right? Okay, so I feel this is a very good introduction, except that it took too long. So let's shut this down for the moment and talk about Gandhian economics. And let me give you my version of what some of the basic principles are. There's Magdi Ely again. I'll be seeing her in a couple of weeks. So I think it's very nice to be revisiting her. But let's turn this down. Okay. Thank you, Laura, Carolina. First, a quote, three quotes actually about the present economic order. The first is from Martin Luther King, so you get a nice transition. In talking about his own upbringing and his intellectual development, which would be called his Ein Bildungsroman if it were a German novel, the story of my education. He said he looked into communism because after you'd had a good look at capitalism, you would want to look around at some of the alternatives. He looked into communism and was partly taken with it for a while, but he finally discovered that while capitalism forgets that man is individual, capitalism forgets that man is social, communism forgets that man is individual. Communism says the individual, as an economic producer and in every other sense, belongs to the state. And in capitalism, you're actually saying that the state belongs to the most aggressive individuals. Basically, that's what you use the state to pass laws so that you can have unbridled competition in which the most aggressive win. That's basically unfortunately, that's basically how those systems play out. Now, John Kenneth Galbraith, the well-known Canadian economist, had another take on it, which was, you know, also very devastating and much more amusing. He said that in capitalism, man exploits man, whereas in communism, it's exactly the other way around. In other words, they're both systems of exploitation, only who does the exploitation is slightly different. Okay, Joy?
So, in communism, it's not good because they try to, like, I guess, homogenize everyone, and there's, like, a really large state.
You know, there's a fairly good literature now on the differences between Gandhian economics and Marxism. And probably one of the best books is by a fellow called Madhu Dandavate. Dandavate means the person who has a stick. I don't know why I had that name. By the way, Eli, would you be, could you turn off the projector? You know how to do that? And his book is simply called Marx and Gandhi. And rather than go into it in detail here, I think I'll just say one thing, which is that both systems are basically materialist systems. You know, Marxism was paraphrased as dialectical materialism. And for Gandhi, he said, I don't care whether it's dialectical or non-dialectical. If it's materialism, I can't use it because it denies the spiritual nature of man. I think I took care of the computer. It's just, yeah. Okay. Really, Gandhian economics rejects both these systems. And a quote about modern economic theory that I got from a book called Essays on Gandhian Economics, of which there are, I think, four chapters in your reader, this quote said that all economics, like most social science, is based on the assumption that the human being is a self-interest optimizer or maximizer. The whole system is oriented around capturing that drive for self-aggrandizement and putting it to work in a way that won't destroy the whole system, which actually turns out to not be possible. And so now we have the system collapsing around our ears. If we have a little more time next time, I'll bring in some of the observations we made by David Corten about how modern economies are imploding. And they're not imploding because the systems need to be tinkered with. They're imploding because the systems are based on a false proposition about human nature, namely the proposition that the best you can get out of people is to harness their greed. Back to the first talk we had, back whenever that was. Remember we talked about negative energy and positive energy, how people thought that they could fix Ladakh by introducing greed. Not stopping to ask themselves, is greed a positive or a negative form of energy? So Gandhi's economic system takes off from an entirely different concept of the human being. And I'm going to tell you, because we're a little bit short on time, just my own sense of what are the important principles of it. But there are also different versions which are a little bit more complicated. But the first, this is, you know, those three things I think I've already commented on. The first is trusteeship, which has to do with the relationship of the person to possessions in this case. But it could also be the relationship of the person to non-material possessions, like personal qualities, capacities. You know, you have, okay, do you have an intellect? If so, how are you going to use that intellect? Are you going to use it to get appreciation from others, get a salary, to get a high position in the nuclear weapons system, or are you going to use it, you can, you know, go to one of these nonprofits, of which there are many. In fact, a friend of mine has recently calculated there are 90,000 organizations worldwide that are doing very, very good work, that are part of a new paradigm, but they don't know about each other. Are you going to join one of those? So the trusteeship is one way, easy way of looking at it. It is the nonviolent equivalent of ownership. In ownership, we say, okay, what is my relationship to that laptop? In ownership, we say, I own that laptop. I can prove it. I stole it fair and square, or however I happened to acquire it. In this case, I paid my hard-earned money, which is the taxpayers of California's hard-earned money, to acquire it, and I've got a bill of sale, and it's illegal for you to take that away from me without asking my permission. Or, you know, you can spam it, you can do things like that, but you can't take it away.
Does trusteeship relate to both material and non-material property?
Yes. Yes, trusteeship relates to both material and non-material properties. It relates to capacities as well as it does to entities, to objects. Thank you for that, Julia. Now, what trusteeship says is no Nagler, trusteeship isn't very polite, no Nagler, you don't own that laptop, you are its trustee. Which means that you have the right to use it as long as you are doing useful work with it, like showing slides in PAX 164A is a perfectly legitimate use of your laptop, and you get to use it for that, and nobody can come and take it away from you. On the other hand, if I start, you know, looking into pornography sites or something like that, that would violate brahmacharya, and I would no longer be a good trustee of that resource. Okay, psychologically, the important dimension here is that my value does not come from that object. whereas this is the big problem in ownership, in capitalism. That's why we have that red line shooting up higher than Mount Everest for some people, while everybody else is just lying flatso on the football field, is not that people who have $50 billion need $50 billion, but they are trying to gratify themselves in a way which is impossible. And there is a statement in the Sanskrit scriptures, na vittena tarpaniyo manushyaha, four devastating words. It says simply, the human being can never be fulfilled by wealth. It just does not work. So once you get into this trap of trying to gratify yourself with possessions, you never get out of it. You just need more and more and more. And this is where Gandhi steps in and says there's enough in the world for everyone's need. There's not enough for everyone's greed. Now, basically then, this is an economy of needs. This is as important as the trusteeship element, whereas modern economies are based on wants. And even in Hind Swaraj, he said, a time is coming when we will look at this mad race for increasing human wants and we will say, what have we done? This is a disaster. So let's talk, this will relate to both of these things. Let's talk about kind of the classes of material possession in Gandhi's scheme. There's a basic level which is the food, clothing, and shelter stuff. We might call this the pre-Maslow needs. Remember we were talking before about new models of human needs. There is no question that as embodied creatures, we need food, shelter, and under most circumstances, clothing, right? There are certain bike rides where you don't need any clothing, but mostly in order to function socially as a human being and not get arrested, you need clothing, even if it's not cold, which it sometimes is, though we're fixing that. It's not going to be cold anywhere in a little while. Now, the point is that these different layers of needs are qualitatively different. Like, up to the point of food, clothing, and shelter, everybody is in that situation. Everybody needs those three. They need roughly the same. You know, you need about 1,500 calories a day. I throw on a couple of lattes just to make it a little more amusing, but basically, to keep yourself alive, that's what you need. And it's qualitatively different in this sense also that as far as Gandhi was concerned, this is the responsibility of the society as a whole. Okay? We have, what, 90,000 homeless people in Northern California alone or something like that, I forget where. If you have one homeless person, society has failed. I was shocked to see, even in Kyoto, by the side of the Kamo River, under a bridge there, some huts that some homeless people had put together. They were a lot nicer than some of our huts, but you know, that's a comment on Japanese architecture, not a comment on our economy. He felt that if there's one person who doesn't have enough of these basic things, it's the responsibility of society to fix that problem. Now, the next set of needs is qualitatively different, and that is that we need tools to do our work. This is very appropriate for us to have these objects, always keeping in mind that we are trustees for those objects. We are not the owners of those objects. But every person has a right to develop his or her capacity for service. And in some cases, that means some tools. In some cases, it means other tools. Here, they start to be very different. To do my work, you know, for various reasons, I need a hybrid car and two computers. I actually have more than that. But in terms of the tools that I need to do my work, yeah, I can identify those things. Now, the qualitative difference here is, while I have every right to have access to them, I do not have a right to say to society, you owe me a new Prius and a Dell laptop. You know, it's my responsibility to get those tools, but I have every right to get them. In fact, I have a responsibility to get them. And here, my tools will be different from another person's tools because their work is different. Everything above that, though, is excess. And in a really strapped economy like India, you shouldn't even have it. So here, society owes it to you. Here, on the tools level, you owe it to yourself. And there's no owing at all. You just should not have things for which you do not have a legitimate use. Once you start accumulating them, we're going to be back on the same old go-around again, where I'm better because I have more. So, yeah.
So the
sure.
tools are used for service, like
yeah.
work should be
different. Yeah. Remember the Gita's theory of action, that every person has an appointed work. That we're born with a set of capacities and weaknesses, and those define what we can do for those around us. Right. Okay. So actually, I guess what I should do is pull this down here primarily, because this relates to needs. We have this set of needs, this set of quote needs, and that set of non-needs. Now, the beauty of trusteeship was, among other things, that it gave you a way to do the transition from the present economy to an economy of simplicity and nonviolence without having a revolution. The problem is that once you're on the 100-yard line, you're up there above Mount Everest, people come and say, we don't think you need all that money. We're going to pass tax laws and take them away from you. And the person will say, oh, yeah, I'd like to see you try it. Fact is, I own all the media networks, and I'm going to frame taxation as a burden, not as a dues that you pay to the culture. And I'm going to frame non-taxation as a revolution. We'll get Jan and Garvis and Jan in here, whoever those two guys were. And they took away basically the tax base from the state of California. That's why our schools are now crumbling into the dirt. And what I'm getting at is that it's very difficult to dispossess wealthy people of their wealth. They don't like it. They have a lot of power. And it leads to revolutions which have been very, very bloody, and they have basically failed everywhere, conspicuously in the communist countries. They didn't even get off the ground. So you need not only a system which is sustainable, but you need a way to transition. I know it's not really a verb, but let's pretend a way to transition into that system without violence. And Gandhi's point was, with trusteeship, you do not have to dispossess anybody of anything. You just have to educate them so that you change their attitude towards it. The minute you feel that you're a trustee and not an owner, you start looking around and say, well, I'm not using this. There's no need for me to keep on possessing it. And eventually you would get to a state of simplicity where you had what you needed and not anything more. Actually, in ancient Greek, the Greek philosophers had an interesting term, pleonexia, which comes from pleon, which means more, and exia means possession, having. And they also felt that there was a definite qualitative line that you passed where you had what you needed, and 1 ounce more would not only mean that somebody else had to have 1 ounce less, which is the way the world seems to work, but it would mean that you would get yourself psychologically disoriented and be off on that slippery slope. Okay, there was only one other, one other major principle that I wanted to put down here. We can go into this more next week if we want to. And that is that economies, like everything else under Swadeshi, should be local and not centralized. Okay. But trusteeship and an economy of needs are really, if you have to reduce it to two principles, you could do it with those. Okay, I'm sorry, I've run over a little bit and you need to pick up your proposals. So let's do that really quickly and get out of the way for the next folks. And have a nice Thanksgiving, by the way. Have a nonviolent Thanksgiving. I'll just put that in on half of turkey sitters.